Witchside Podcast is a proud member of the Witchside Media Collective.
This week's episode is brought to you by our Amazon affiliate link.
Yeah, all you need to do is go to our website and click on the Amazon link there. It'll take you to the Amazon page. Just check out like you normally would. Wouldn't cost you anything extra, and Amazon gives us a little bit of a kickback.
Yeah, so, you know, if you're already planning on buying something through Amazon, might as well use our link. Doesn't cost you anything extra, and we get a little bit of money for it. If you're looking for something to buy, check out the Hurrah Lip Balm, all vegan. I hear it's pretty fucking amazing.
The cherry and cinnamon look good to me.
Mm-mm.
You'd probably like that Earl Grey.
Yeah, I do like Earl Grey.
You have tea all over your lips.
This is episode 130.
Yeah, we have Doyle Wolfgang von Frankenstein from Doyle.
And Alissa White-Gluz from Arch Enemy. Pretty fucking amazing to get them both on. They're right in the middle of tours and whatnot, so we only got them for a little bit. But it's a great conversation, so stick around for that. What news and events do we have going on this week, Jordan?
Well, the day this releases is May the 4th. Which, you know, may the 4th be with you.
May the 4th be with you. You know, I had somebody the other day actually ask me, what day is Cinco de Mayo? So if you don't know what Cinco de Mayo is, it's the 5th of May.
So that's also
happening, yeah.
And also, find a local anti-police brutality demonstration in your area.
If you can't find one,
make one.
Yeah, exactly. Start one. Just put it out there. People will show up. It's super important. Just get out in the fucking streets. For the slingshot this week, May 10th, 1963, Birmingham agrees to end segregation after the country repudiates the police violence at demonstrations. I sincerely hope you guys enjoy this episode. How's your guys' day going?
Pretty good. How about you?
Yeah, you know, right before we came on, we had a quick power outage, made me kind of flip the fuck out for a second.
Yeah.
Oh, where are you guys located?
We're out in Utah,
Salt Lake City.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, cool. Alissa, you're vegan, right? You've been vegan for what, like 15 years?
Yeah. I think 16, actually, but who's counting, right?
Yeah, once you get that high, you kind of lose count. I kind of, I see people post all the time. They have like their, you know, oh, I've been vegan for 5 years. I'm like, oh, well, I remember the year ish, but I don't remember the day or anything like that. That
I went. Oh yeah. I don't remember the day. I remember what grade I was in school, but that's about it.
What grade were you in when you went vegan?
Grade 8. So I was in high school. What's so funny? Yeah, I was in grade 8.
What was that catalyst for you, like that really pushed you over? Because you were raised vegetarian, right?
Yeah, I was already vegetarian. Very close to vegan. My whole family is. And then I just started... You know, I started wanting to become more active with animal rights. And so I started doing a little bit more research into factory farming and how animals are exploited for various consumer products. And this was before social media and stuff, too. So this, you know, there was a lot more or there was a lot less like bullshit articles out there, I should say. It was a little bit easier to. I mean, it was harder to do research in one way, but it was also easier in another way because the research that you would do was probably, you know, from an actual credible source and not just like clickbait advertising. And and so I started doing that and I started learning about factory farming. And I just realized that, you know, the egg industry and the dairy industry were no different than the meat industry. And so I didn't want to support it anymore. And so I just stopped. It just was pretty easy, actually, to just stop. So
You probably got like a ton of support from your family, it sounds like, in that transition.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I'm pretty lucky in that sense that I come from a family who are all very like-minded when it comes to animal rights and even stuff like music too. So they're very supportive of, you know, my lifestyle and my career and everything.
What's crazy is when I went vegetarian, I was 11 and my parents made me promise I wouldn't go vegan. That's actually got me interested in it. Like, well, why are they saying no to this? What is this whole thing?
Yeah.
So Doyle, what kind of brought you on this? Was it really Alissa that kind of brought you onto the bandwagon?
Yeah, actually, she came out to visit me and we were in New York and we were scrambling to get her back on a plane to get her on a tour or some shit. And she's like, we were starving and we're running through the city real fast to try and get where we got to go. And she's like, well, if we can't get me something to eat, we'll get you something to eat. And I was like, fuck that. I will never eat something in front of you that would disrespect you or make you, you know, not happy. So everything that we would go out to eat is what really started. I said every time we'd go somewhere, we'd just eat whatever she wanted. And I didn't know what anything was. So she would order everything. And every time I would bite something, as soon as I would bite it, I would look at her and go, holy shit, this is so fucking good. And when I ate processed foods and meats, I went out to eat 10 times, 9.5 of the meals sucked and one of them was okay. Like a half of it was okay. And now 10 out of 10 meals is great. You know what I mean? I mean, I've never eaten anything that sucked. Everything is just fucking fantastic.
I know Alissa kind of has a very ethical standpoint on the veganism. Have you kind of adopted that as well?
Yes. She showed me a lot of videos and kind of enlightened me on what the fuck is really going on. And it's pretty fucked up.
It's way fucked up.
So I imagine that you guys travel a lot. Is it hard traveling and being vegan while on tour?
We got Happy Cow and she's one of the greatest food hunters in the world. So everybody says, oh, meat eaters are hunters. No. Not on the road, the vegan people are, because we got to find that shit.
Yeah.
You know?
No, it's pretty easy. I mean, like, I know some people say, like, oh, I want to be vegan, but I could never do it. It's just too hard. And, you know, I understand that it can be hard if you're just starting out. But, like, if I can be vegan in, you know, China and Russia and Colombia and Japan and wherever else I go in the world, where I can't communicate, don't speak the language, and it's like really not a part of the culture, and I'm still vegan, and I've never once, like, not, you know, I've never strayed from veganism in 16 years because it's just, it's gross to me. I don't want to. But, you know, if I can do it, then like you can do it in your house. You know, even if you're in a small town, like there's nothing that prevents you from cooking your own meals, even if you don't have like a vegan restaurant at your disposal. It's really quite easy. It's just a matter of wanting to do it, you know? So, you know, I have friends or people that are like, oh, well, I'm vegetarian and I want to go vegan, but I just can't give up cheese, or I just can't, you know, I can't do without this or that. And I'm like, well, you can, you just don't want to badly enough yet. But when you do want to, you'll do it, because it's really pretty easy.
You could do anything you want to do. You just got to fucking do it.
Yeah, exactly.
I know we were talking to Scott from Earth Crisis, and he said that when they first started touring, being vegan was pretty hard. Like that was when 16, 17 years ago when mm-hmm. they first started touring. But now everywhere they go, everyone wants to show them the awesome, amazing vegan food in their city. So now it's hard being healthy, but easy being vegan.
That's true, actually, because we always get people bringing us like cupcakes and vegan treats. And I mean, when I first started touring, which was like about 10 years ago, I guess, it was also pretty uncommon to find vegan food anywhere. And I wasn't in like a bus where I had a fridge, you know, but I still made it work. I would carry a cooler in the trailer of the van. You know, we would drive a van and trailer, and I'd have a cooler in there, and I would stop at the grocery store and like get a bunch of fruits and vegetables and salad stuff and sandwich stuff and keep it in the cooler and get ice at the bar that we were playing at. And, you know, and so, I mean, it's always possible. It just takes a tiny bit of effort, and it takes, you know, wanting to eat good food too, because I could also probably stop at like, I think Burger King has vegan fries or something, and I could just eat crap like that all day if I wanted to. But of course, that's like really not appealing to me. So instead, I would go out of my way to like make a salad or something healthy.
Also, on the road, when you show up at venues, they'll get you vegan food too. If you put it on your rider and all the festivals you do, there's tons of vegan food.
Oh yeah, because there's a lot of vegan musicians, actually. Mm-hmm. I find it funny when people are like, oh, being vegan isn't metal, or being vegan isn't punk. And it's like, dude, like more than 50% of the musicians in these genres are vegan. So, like it's amazing how many you actually run into.
Well, it's amazing how much punk, hardcore, and even a lot of metal influences people to become vegan and you know, explore the social, you know, movements behind everything.
Well, it's also rebellious pretty much in a way too, you know. I just love that it trips everybody's trigger too. I love making posts on Instagram about vegan and they all go fucking tar, everything's bacon, this and this, just I just love it.
So if you've gotten
it is nonconformist too, so it's funny that people really you know you're doing something right when it pisses off a lot of people.
Yeah, it's great.
So that was actually a question I was going to ask, is what kind of responses do you get from your fans about being vegan?
Good ones and assholes, and I just throw them off my site.
Yeah, I mean, in person, I usually get really, really positive responses. You know, often fans will, you know, at meet and greets, or if I just meet the fans or whatever, they'll tell me, oh, I'm vegan, or I just became vegan because of you, or because of that song you did, or because of, you know, an interview I heard with you. And that's really amazing, actually. That motivates me to keep going.
I'm actually starting to get that too, that I'm going vegan because of you, blah, blah, blah.
And that's awesome, because I mean, veganism, not only is ethically, is it just the only actual, it's actually the only ethical way to live, but it's also healthy, you know? So it's like, we're actually doing something good for the person as they are doing something good for the planet.
Yeah, it's really good for I think it's good for a bodybuilding diet. I mean, since I've been doing it, I'm fucking so much more shredded. Everybody's like, wow, you're so much bigger. I'm like, nope, I lost fucking 10 pounds, you know.
So do you get those people that are saying, where do you get your protein, and how do you respond to them with that?
It's everywhere.
Well, it's just funny, because it's honestly, you could probably respond to most of those people and say, well, where do you get your protein? And they wouldn't know.
Yeah, no, so
you
true.
Know, they'll be like, probably that Big Mac I ate, maybe. Like, they don't really know themselves. They just hear, I mean, the protein industry is just like the meat industry or the dairy industry. I mean, it's not like cow's milk is actually good for you, but it's been marketed as giving you strong bones and having a ton of calcium in it. So people think, oh, if I don't want to get osteoporosis, I have to have cow's milk. But in reality, the best way to keep the calcium in your bones is to not be eating meat. So it's all about the marketing, And I mean, I used to work in a gym. I go to a gym all the time, and obviously so does Doyle. And like the protein industry and the way that's marketed at people who are working out is just as bad. You know, it's like you need this many grams of protein and you need to have this whey isolate and concentrate. And people just think that they need this exorbitant amount of protein in order to get big muscles or get in better shape. But when it comes down to it, it's like, what you eat isn't going to give you muscles. It's working out that's going to give you muscles. So you have to do that. And of course, you do have to keep your diet in mind, and you have to make sure that you get the right macros and the right micros. But, you know, like there's a lot of protein in plant foods that people just generally ignore because it's just not marketed. Like nobody markets broccoli as like a protein dense food, or nobody markets broccoli at all. There's no ads for broccoli.
Broccoli's like it's like WD-40. It doesn't need advertisement anymore.
Yeah.
So what are some of like the favorite things that you've eaten around the world?
I was thinking that. Well, it's funny because in Japan, everything is basically fish-based, and so people ask me a lot, like, how do I do it in Japan? How do I stay vegan in Japan? Because I go there a lot, and I've spent a lot of time there, actually. And the funny thing, though, is Japan is, there is a lot of fish there, but there's also a lot of seaweed and a lot of rice. And there's, like, a lot of little treats that they make in Japan that they just don't make anywhere else. And one of them is called, like, an onigiri, which is like rice wrapped in seaweed with like a plum in the middle, which sounds really strange, but it's actually super delicious. And I usually just overdose on those when I go there because they're really cheap and you can find them at any sort of corner store. But even in the past, I would say 6 years or whenever it was the first time I went to Japan, I've seen like in Tokyo, at least there's like a bunch of vegan restaurants that have sprung up. So and even in Shanghai when I was in China, I went to a really good vegan restaurant. So I mean it's growing. There's vegan restaurants everywhere, and even if there isn't, like there's fruit everywhere and there's vegetables everywhere, so you can always eat that.
So let's try to get off the topic of vegan a little bit. Alissa, I was gonna ask you, do you feel that women are given enough exposure or support in the music industry?
Yeah, I do actually, because I think that like with any other marketing campaign, people realize that a female attracts more attention than a male. And this is just true. I mean, this you could be selling shaving cream or a metal album, and if you put a female on it, you're going to get more eyes on it than if you put a male on it. I think that's a lot of the reasons that even bands that don't have women musicians, they'll have a girl on the cover of the album or on the t-shirt or whatever. And I mean, I don't know why we're wired that way as humans, but I think we just are. Like, we just naturally like to look at females a little bit more than males.
They look better to me.
I don't know. When I draw or paint, I often draw and paint females, and it's not a sexual attraction or anything like that, but it's just a nice thing to paint. But so I think for that reason, women are given, you know, a good spotlight in the music scene. But with that being said, there's also, it's sort of a double-edged sword, because every time we are given the spotlight, we have to kind of fight against the, you know, the inevitable sex sells label and be like, well, actually, I'm not doing anything sexual. I'm just making some music, and it's the music I'm selling. So I mean, I could be completely covered head to toe with just my hands and my face showing, not doing any sort of sexual move, screaming like a banshee, and then I'll still get sex sells.
That's like the Ward Turner video. Yeah. So somebody posted, oh, it was sex sells. She's covered head to toe.
I'm actually covered like up to my neck and
up to your wrist.
Down to my wrists and my pants on. I'm like, how is that sexual? Like, I'm not doing anything sexy. But you know what, if you're the kind of person that automatically thinks of sex every time you see a female, then that's kind of unfortunate that you're so deprived. But I think it's a double-edged sword. You know, we get, as women in music, well, especially in metal, I guess, we tend to get the spotlight quite quite easily, I would say, but we have to sort of direct the spotlight to the music constantly and not at the fact that we're female.
Do you feel that, like I know in the hardcore scene, I was talking a long time ago, Candace from Walls of Jericho was talking about to me, like, really the inherent patriarchy inside the hardcore metal and punk scene, and how misogynistic a lot of it is, and the people inside of it don't even realize how bad it can really get. And it kind of opened my eyes a little bit to it. Do you see the same thing?
Yeah, I mean, it's tricky because it's really bad in some ways, but then again, it also really depends on who you're with. Like, I'm lucky enough to be surrounded by people who are very much used to having, you know, like a strong, powerful female around, because Angela was in this band before I was, but, you know, I'm around people who are used to having a woman as their equal, as their singer, as a fellow musician, but, you know, it used to happen a lot. I would go into a show to, you know, load in gear or set up merch, and it was, oh, whose girlfriend are you? Or, oh, are you a Jagger girl? Or, where do you want to set up your merch? Are you the merch girl? And it's like, well, no, I'm the leader of this band, actually. But, you know, it can be bad. But I'm actually in a pretty good spot right now. I'm around good people. You know, you always run into people in other bands or sometimes crew members from other touring acts or even just fans that think that you're there for some other reason. But generally speaking, I would say after they see an Arch Enemy show that they kind of shut the fuck up. So,
as a vegan parent, one of the things that scares me the most is my daughter, like, falling away and not, you know, following the ethics that I would like her to live. And you being raised vegetarian, like, what kind of advice would you give me to make sure that she kind of stays that path?
Yeah, I've thought about that a lot, actually. Because I'm at an age where, like, some of my friends are starting to have kids, and I mean, I'm not going down that route, but if I did, obviously they would be raised vegan. But I remember when I was pretty young, like probably like 4 or 5 years old, maybe 6 years old, I remember like asking my mom, like, well, what is that stuff that my friends in school are eating, you know, because I never ate it. And she always told me, like, you know, this is what we eat and this is why we eat it. And you're, you know, if anyone asks, you can say you're a vegetarian and they'll know what you're talking about. And I remember it being like weird at the time. Like, I would tell the teachers or whatever, like, I'm a vegetarian, and they would laugh because it was like weird to have a really small kid saying I'm vegetarian, you know? My mom just told me, she was like, well, this is a part of a pig. So if somebody's eating a ham, it means that they killed the pig and they sliced up its leg, or, you know, and like, she just told me what it was. And when she told me that, I was like really confused. Like, well, why do they, but how does the pig, like, what, doesn't the pig need his leg? And then, you know, she was like, yeah, well, they kill the pig to take the pieces of the pig's body. And she wasn't doing it in a gruesome way. She was just very matter of fact telling me, this is what that is. And so to me, that didn't make any sense. I was like, why would you eat that? You know, like, that pig needs that, not me. Or, you know, like, the cow needs her body. I don't need that. And so I remember at a certain point being like, oh, well, maybe I should try eating that. And then as soon as my mom explained to me what it was, I, you know, very quickly was like, that doesn't sound right to me. And I have a younger brother, actually, who, I, you know, this is a tangent, but it's still related. I do think that men actually sometimes have a harder time being vegetarian or vegan, just because there's a stigma, again, in advertising that it's manly to eat meat and whatever. But I do have a younger brother, and when he got into his early 20s, which is the time when most guys usually start to, like, want to become their own man and start, you know, they usually start, like, working out and trying to become adults. And he was vegetarian his whole life, of course. And then he had about a year where he started eating meat, actually, which was really strange because he was raised in the same environment as me and my sister. And, but, you know, it was like his teenage rebellion, I guess. And mm-hmm. so he, for a year, ate meat. He tried all the different kinds of meat, even like lobster and stuff, which I to me, that's like one of the worst. I can't handle that. But, and he did that, and, you know, and in his head he was, and he even talked to me about it, and he was like, no, I need to get bigger. I need muscle. I need protein. And he did all that. And then after about a year, he was like, that wasn't the right move. And now he's like almost vegan. Like he, you know, he tried it, found out what it was all about, and decided that he didn't want to do that. He didn't like the ethics. He didn't like how it made him feel. And now he's like a workout maniac too. He's in amazing shape. Like he could probably run a triathlon tomorrow and win it. He's in really good shape. And he's, you know, completely plant-based. So yeah, I think the most important thing is to give, I mean, just from my experience, I think the most important thing is to give the child the information and give them the option, but just make it clear that, you know, like if you do choose to eat meat, you are going to be responsible for killing animals. And again, that's not propaganda. That's just true. And I think that even if, like my brother, like even if someone would stray for a little bit, maybe that's just their way of discovering why they need to be vegan. And I do think they'll come back to it.
Doyle, what kind of parenting advice would you give?
I just tell my daughter what she's eating, and she really doesn't get it yet. But I'm trying to get her to switch into being at least vegetarian. She's starting to eat different things. She's autistic, so she gets stuck on certain things, and that's all she wants, you know. So it's a little more difficult for me, but yeah, I agree with what Alissa said. Yeah, you just explain it to them, and you give them the option and the choice and the opinion, you know.
Yeah, there was a video that was like circulating on online a while ago, like about a little boy. I think he was like speaking Spanish or something. It wasn't in English, but there were subtitles. But it was like a little boy, and the mom was feeding him like octopus and rice or something like that. And he asked, like, mm-hmm. well, where's the octopus's head? Is it still in the ocean? And like, and the mom was like, well, no, we have to cut off the head so we can take the legs. And he was like, but the octopus needs his legs like to get around. And you could see that.
He showed me that.
Yeah. And you could see that moment of horror, of realization on the kid's face of like, what? We killed the octopus. And I remember having that same moment when I was a kid. So I really related to that video. And then, you know, the kid's like, I don't want to eat that. And the mom's like, okay, just eat the rice then, you know? And I do think that a lot of kids don't, they're never given that explanation. They're never given that moment to realize that if they're eating meat, they're killing an animal. And they grow up and they become adults who still don't realize that, or they just put blinders on because they like what they're eating and they don't want to start like digging into things and changing their lifestyle. But when properly informed, I think most human beings would have that same reflex to the thought that they're eating a dead animal. Like I do think that when it's put in that perspective, most people would be horrified.
Yeah, people don't really understand, you know, what's really happening. Yeah. You know, it's hard to explain it to them. Especially kids, they don't really understand how fucking brutal it really is.
And they also don't understand why their parents would do that. Because when you're a kid, your parents are like the best, you know? Yeah. So it's like, why would you kill that octopus, mom?
Yeah, my daughter is running into that. She just, her class at school went to an aquarium, and she decided not to go because she didn't want to participate in that. And the next day, all the kids were like, well, my mom says that it's okay, and they're right. And she's like, well, they're wrong. Yeah, the kids, they don't really, you know.
It's true. I mean, I think, I definitely think it's better to have kids informed. I mean, you want to protect them to a certain extent, but I had the same thing too, that when I was younger, everyone went on like a whale watching journey of some sort. But I remember doing the research and seeing that it was like also like a fishing trip, and I just didn't want to go. So I didn't go, and nobody really understood why I was opposed to it. But
well, we know you guys got to run pretty quickly. So thank you for jumping on with us. How can people, you know, follow your work and get in contact with you and see what you guys are up to?
Well, for me, you can, I have Facebook, tw- Twitter, Instagram, and Tumblr, which, I mean, I think my Instagram is just my full name, Alissa White-Gluz. If you search on Facebook, Alissa White-Gluz fans, I have like an official page there where I post all the relevant information, or the Arch Enemy page, or there's also archenemy.net with all my tour dates. And for Doyle,
officialdoyle.com is our website, and I don't know the Facebook, honestly.
I don't know
the Twitter if there is one, but Instagram is Doyle WBF.
Yeah.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Well, we end every episode saying fuck, shit, damn. Could you do that for us this week?
Fuck, shit, damn.
Is that right?
Fuck, shit.
Sweet. Well, thank you guys so much, and I hope you guys have a wonderful Sunday.
Okay, right. Thank you.
Thank you.
Have a good one, guys.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. This week you heard Abominator by Doyle.
And right now you're listening to
You Will Know My Name by Arch Enemy.
iTunes. Just go rate and review us. It's super helpful. Super easy to do.
We say it every week.
We're just not ever going to stop until everyone does it.
Everyone.
Everyone.
We know how many of you listen.
And we know how many people have done it. There's a big difference.
Huge.
I mean, in the 99+ percentile difference. So just go do it. It's easy. If you've already done it, you're awesome. You're amazing. We fucking love you. And we just ask that you do it to someone else's device without them knowing.
Hashtag ghost review.
That's it. That's all it takes. We also have social media. We do things all the time on there. So like us, follow us, retweet us. Whatever you do on social media that you do.
Be our friend. You can find out all of our accounts at whichsidepodcast.com. Just click on the social tab. And we're done. Fuck shit down.
Fuck shit down.
Which Side Podcast is hosted and produced by Jordan Halliday and Jeremy Parkin of the Which Side Media Collective, with web design by Jordan Halliday and sound design by Jeremy Parkin. Booking by Mari Halliday. Theme music by Commandantes. Go to wishsidecollective.org to check out the other shows in the collective. As always, fuck shit damn. Thank you.